early and prescient on the foundational problems with China, and you know we're starting to see them realized. What's your take? Where do they go from here? And maybe give a little bit of background in terms of that foundational issues.
So when we first built the relationship with Mizuho, we discussed how the repricing of risk in China was at the very, very beginning and had a really long way to go. And your entire portfolio, all of your investments, had to be reviewed in terms of a very significant, I would say, severe repricing of risk across the board. And the story was that there were these pieces that were potentially trouble for them. So the demographic story, right? The middle income trap.
Real estate, education, right?
There's just a huge number of pieces. But the answer was, in other words, challenges for any government, right? Wouldn't have been easy for anybody, right? Low income to middle income can be done. Many countries have done it. Middle income to high income is a small club. Many have failed. Getting to middle income and then stalling out, stagnating. Mexico, in some ways, is a quintessential example of this. So was China going to, let's say, break the mold with low overall human capital? They got great universities at the top, but they got low graduation rates from high school. They got 600 million people outside the world economy living without medical care, without education. Okay, so we know about the 700 million got lifted up. There's 600 million that got forgotten. So the numbers weren't good on the middle income. The demographic numbers weren't good, and many other things that we could talk about. The real estate thing, which we discussed very early, that was coming. And, of course, this time is the same.
Right.
Okay. So it's no easy way out of that. But everyone would say to me, okay, fine, we get that, but they have the secret weapon. They have this fantastically efficient authoritarian regime. They build these great airports. They do just so much great stuff. So that's their ace in the hole. And I said, you're not going to believe this, but that's their biggest problem. Their demographic, their middle income trap, all of that stuff pales in comparison to the fact that what you think is going to get them out of this is what's going to dig them deeper and deeper into this. And what's the reason for that? So Communist Party is a monopoly, a Leninist structure. Many people thought this was dead, right? They thought communism is dead. Nobody believes the ideology. And I kept saying, whether they believe or don't believe, they have a Leninist party structure, which means that they have this monopoly. And you can't have half a monopoly, right? You can't be half pregnant. You either have the monopoly or you don't. So if you liberalize the economy, you hold the political monopoly tight. In fact, you might tighten it, the political monopoly, while you're opening up the economy. If you liberalize the politics, if you open up the party, you say, okay, we're going to have one party rule, but we're going to have debate inside the party. And some wiseacre comes along from Princeton and says, well, you know, I don't want your party. I want another party. And they say, wait a minute, debate within the party's monopoly. And so you get this problem where there's no reform equilibrium. There's no political reform equilibrium where you open up politically and then you get to a stable outcome. You open up politically and you unravel the thing, right? Hungary in 56, Czechoslovakia in 68, Gorbachev in the Soviet Union, and Xi Jinping, before he became the general secretary, was the head of the party school. And the main subject at the party school was no Gorbachev in China, period. That was it. And so this has been a lifelong project for him. Jiang Zemin thought he had a brilliant idea. He's going to take the millionaires and make them party members, right? He's going to take the private sector and put it into the party. The three represents. You probably forgot this. The 90s was a long time ago in a land far, far away. It didn't work, right? The millionaires come into the party. The party's control was lessened, not improved. So Xi Jinping comes along and says, okay, instead of taking the private sector millionaires and put them in a party, we're going to take the party and shove it into all the private sector companies and reassert our control that way. So that's him. And he's playing for keeps. This is not a whim. This is not something that's passing, like, oh, next year it's all going to be finished. He's going to apologize and say it was a bad idea. I didn't mean to reinsert party control over the private sector. I didn't mean to destroy the tech companies that control the public sphere and are a threat to the Communist Party's monopoly. I didn't mean to eliminate the private sector education companies, which socialize youth in values that are different from the party's values. I take it all back, right? So this is structural. It's structural and it's permanent and it's going to go on. And that's why he got in charge.